Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Critical Archaeological Mediation Session 2, hosted by Les Rencontres Interdisciplinaires d'Hexagramme 2020, Edition Saint-Poétique. The title of this first edition of Hexagramme Interdisciplinary Summit refers to the neologism created by the Canadian Beth Dempster, which she invented as an alternative to urban planning analysis centered on the concept of autopoiesis. The symposium is conceived under this key concept of distribution and sharing, as elaborated further by Donna Haraway in 2016. The autonomous subject is a fiction. Autonomy, like agency elsewhere, only exists by, with, and in the sharing between multiple forces, materialities, processes, and entities, human and other than human. The central question of the symposium is expressed as follows. How can the current context, including the pandemic happening in the era of said Anthropocene, allow for the experimentations of the sharing of autonomy and agency? The organization of this symposium is a pooling of interest between the organizers, publics, and participants. The digital platform proposes to go beyond dissemination by adapting participatory methods. Produced jointly by Hexagramme Scientific Committee, the production team, participants, and publics, the platform is a full-fledged research creation project. The objective is to reflect collectively on the sharing of autonomy in action, to practice the sharing of autonomy and agency, social solidarity, and research in action. Today, Prof. Marie-Pierre Boucher and I have the pleasure to discuss with design and computation arts students from Concordia University, enrolled in the studio seminar Critical Materiality, and communication students from University of Toronto enrolled in the course Media Archaeology. A large part of practice-based research transpires in form and in the experience of sensory perception. What happens when the studio and material practices move to public space? How can research creation in the making be communicated and experienced? This activity aims at questioning practice in relation to materials and materiality, objects, technologies, media and techniques, and social environmental topics. This two-day activity aims at renewing the conditions in which creation takes place, is exhibited and communicated, and will involve workshops, roundtables, and open discussions. Before we start, let me briefly introduce today's presentations. Our first panel is entitled Deobsolescence, Making Futures by Reactivating the Past. Grouping Natalie Banger, Young Chen, Ariel Cran, Tyler Greiling, Alec Matheson, Patrick Pierce, Yilong Zhang, the presentation asked the following questions. What can we learn and reapply from the past to better understand our current day social material relationships? How can repurposing materials and knowledge help to increase our agency as makers and help us find meaning in our roles as designers, consumers, and citizens of the world? After a short break at 11 a.m., our second panel is entitled From One Material to Another, Translation as a Method for Engaging with Senses and Communities. Considering that materials carry potential for agency, interactions, and affects, Shireen Almjawer, Janice Chun, Gabriel Diaz, Golris Farzamfar, Jessica Filippelli, Cassandra Liebardis, Maxime Pigeon, Agnesha Sangrapila, Ashley Tan ask, how can material translation create new human experiences? Dear students, your turn.
Morning. Before we, just give me a sec here, before we jump into our discussion, I just wanted to give basically present a couple things. We've broken our presentation up into two sections. One is obsolescence, and then there's another section called deobsolescence. In between these two sections, we have a couple fun little videos, infomercials, and we'll have some experimentations on screen if you're interested. Later on, we'll do a little experiment with the logo programming language on your phone. So now, Alice already presented our students, and I think right now, if we can go, yeah, next slide. So basically, I'm going to Natalie is going to introduce, start off the, I'm going to pass the baton on to Natalie, who's going to sort of describe our current situation. This welcome to a world of waste. And yeah.
Okay, there we go. Sorry about that.
Okay.
Yeah, so welcome to the not so wonderful world of waste. We wanted to touch on this a little bit to start off with just the general state of waste right now. It's especially relevant to us as Canadians, because as much as we like to think of ourselves as a very environmentally friendly country, we actually produce more undiverted solid waste per capita every year than any other country on Earth. So at the moment, as of 2016, which is the last numbers, it was 720 kilos per year, which is slightly down from a peak a few years ago in 2006. It was over 800 kilos per year, but that's still the most in the world. And this is only counting undiverted waste, which means that goes to landfill or incineration. It doesn't include what's sent to recycling programs or composting. And this, it counts from both residential and non-residential waste. And it's actually very important to consider that non-residential sources like industry, manufacturing, that's the majority of this at about 62%. So basically, no matter how important it is to act responsibly on an individual level, there are systemic issues that really need to be addressed in order to make a real impact. So next, Ariel.
Yeah, so even though like all food waste occurs generally, like it occurs in all stages of the food supply chain, but actually private households are responsible for the largest portion of bio waste. And so like approximately 40 to 50% of food waste happens at the level of consumer. And like, of course there's the food that we just can't avoid wasting, like bones or vegetable peelings, eggshells, tea bags, coffee grounds. But the problem is that often we waste good food because we either buy too much, we cook too much, or we don't store it properly. And so like 63% of the food Canadians throw away is usually food that could have been eaten. And so we really need to be more conscious about that.
And I'm just gonna jump in here to mention too, when food waste and other organic materials are thrown away into the landfill, because they're buried, they don't have access to oxygen. And so as they break down, they can't break down completely. And so release much higher amounts of methane, which is a much more powerful greenhouse gas than carbon dioxide. So it's not just bad in terms of physical or in terms of solid materials, it's terrible for our climate as well. So next,
So thank you for my mates make the point about food waste and the landfills. So I'm gonna support with some interesting research findings and also archaeology thinking about the landfill and the food waste. So there's a famous project with this called Tucson Garbage Project, and it's ran from 1973 until 2005, and it was led by Professor Roger. So before Roger's work, people believed that they will waste the less expensive food in times of economic recession, but ideas is not. So for example, like the beef. So people think people bought lots of beef that more than their need and threw away after the expire days. And also, Natalie, can you roll down to the next page?
Thank you. Yeah. Oh, there we go.
Yeah. And also, if you're looking at these two images, it's these amazing findings in this project, because this is a 40-year hot dog, and these newspapers can be read after 25 years, and it's as fresh as the day they were issued. And also in this study, it can be found that in 25 years, people's living habits has been changed in some certain aspects, but still some garbage, some waste still appears repeatedly. And the facts is not like people said. And this means the consumption habits and the food waste are still retained in people's lives. We can also know, what we can redesign for tomorrow and avoid some mistakes. Thank you.
Great. I think this is Tyler.
Yep, you're up.
Yeah. So, So when we're talking about waste and e-waste in specificity, I think one of the important things we need to remember about obsolete technology is environmental and human impact. And with that, we should be aware of it on both ends of the product life cycle. So, for example, if we don't really think about e-waste in the beginning, but if we're looking at things like the outsourcing of raw materials for a lot of these precious minerals, there's huge environmental impacts and labor law violations. All you have to do is, you know, go to the DRC and look at the, for example, the mining of tantalum, copper, lithium, anything like that. These raw materials are being used in things like circuit boards, wirings, and batteries. So it's important to remember that the environmental impact and the human impact happens on both ends of the spectrum. Now, obviously, on the other end, we also have, you know, because of these short lifespans, stemming from planned obsolescence, batteries is a huge thing from mobile devices. They end up in the landfills only after a few years. Obviously, we know the product life cycle of mobile devices becoming shorter every year. So that's a very big issue as well. And also, you also have to look, like I mentioned, about those lithium ion batteries and chemical reactions and other subsequent e-waste results in tons of environmental damage. There are instances of entire cities and regions just being evacuated because of the catastrophe that is stemming from all these chemical reactions. And another issue we have here is just to mention is attempts at these recyclings of the e-waste is often offset by decontamination and transportation of materials. That impact alone is great on the environment. So I'm going to pass it on to Yilong here.
Hello. So today's semiconductor industry is one of the most invested by superpowers in the world to show its comprehensive national strength. Of course, the newer manufacturing technology means better power efficiency and can be more competitive. And it is the technology that will continue to power our future. If that does not sound familiar, let me briefly remind you what happened during the 1950s. The nuclear power stations has many advantages. It does not produce any smokes and greenhouse gases, and consider it as the safest method to generate power. If it is so safe, why do we need wasting money to build containment facilities outside power stations? And so you all know how Chernobyl went. So besides, nuclear power station do produce nuclear waste that could be way dangerous than greenhouse gas, since nuclear waste will be radioactive for hundreds or even thousands of years. Of course, that's not our problem, right? But e-waste is a problem serious as nuclear waste, and it happening in our generation. Next page, please. You may say, don't worry, companies like Apple will make them more environmental friendly by reducing the size of iPhone boxes and using recycled aluminum for their laptops. But don't get me wrong, those are definitely better than nothing, but they are still top of the iceberg. So let me do a quick survey. Why did you upgrade your smartphones. Next page. You can go to that link to what? So I will look at the result later, but let's move on to next page. So this is display account almost half the total cost of the bill of materials. But what if we could only upgrade the component that we want to, like a better CPU, better camera, or larger battery? Next page, please. So that's a brilliant idea, right? So unfortunately, the project area is canceled by Google. It's not happening. And for everyone who don't know, I actually was back to for since the beginning. And please, next. So here's the proof. When someone tagged me on Facebook, I said, to be honest, I don't think it will be successful. But why? Let me explain. So do you remember where phone still modular before iPhone? Next slide. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Always, yeah.
There we go.
Sorry about that. My internet froze. I think, where are we at? This one, yeah?
Yeah.
I'll put it back up.
Do you still remember phone modular before iPhone? Batteries are user replaceable. User can have a larger storage space by simply popping an SD card, and the glass and display are actually separated, which means you could replace the broken glass instead of the whole display module. And nowadays, very few phone manufacturers still support expandable storage, but none of them battery are user replaceable. How did this happen? So next slide. So it can be explained in a simple diagram. It's like people buy new product and with a higher degree of integration, and which is more desirable and harder to repair. Because of that, people tend to buy new product when things broken instead of repair things, which creates a cycle of waste, I guess. So this is something, I'm not saying that some companies fault. However, it's natural technology innovation that causing this. Let me briefly introduce two concepts. The first is the technology S-curve. Next page, please. So when technology becomes more mature, it will reach a tipping point where the innovation slowing down. That's where the new technology will take over the old technology, such as how transistor replacing the vacuum tube. Next page. Or how Apple switching from PowerPC to Intel and from Intel to Apple Silicon, ARM-based Apple Silicon in recent years. And during those transitions, a huge level of integration will happen. Next page. Besides that, during the S-curve, the more laws also play an important role to accelerate the integration of technologies, which means the modularity will be a thing in the past. And both of them contribute to the increasing level of integration in electronic devices, which means it's harder for users to repair or repair the product, and they will likely to buy new things in that fix them. So how do we solve it? At least slow it down. So maybe I was wrong. Perhaps makers' culture could save us from this trouble. So we could finally let me summarize by playing a video made speak by the writer of Chernobyl. Next page.
To this. The truth is always there. Right now, we live in a time where there is essentially a global assault on the truth. And we comfort ourselves with stories because they're comforting. It's hard to say that, for instance, the climate is changing and threatening our existence. It's much easier to say, or is it? It doesn't seem like that way today. Well, you can do that for a while, but eventually the truth catches up. Eventually it does. We cannot hide from it. And Chernobyl to me is a story about what happens when people put lies above the truth. The truth does not care, and it will get you.
Yeah, so we cannot ignore the events that it is happening in our generation, and we cannot ignore it until it gets even more serious. So let's move on to next topic.
To this. The truth is always there.
Okay. So this kind of leads us to a blatant question, which is recycling. And I could put a lot of statistics, but basically we know that a lot of recycling actually doesn't get used. It just stockpiles in recycling centers, notably glass, which Alice has worked a lot on, because also we don't have the most sophisticated necessarily recycling or processing centers. So this is an issue. So my work relates to upcycling, and I had a chance to visit an eco center, a couple of them actually in the Montreal area. And as part of a project where I was looking for some materials, can you slide please? So eco-centers are drop-off recycling centers in Quebec where people come and they drive. And I was asking myself, could this be a good source of supplies for upcyclers who want to do projects? Slide. So you go there with your car and you drop in, you drive in, and then sometimes on weekends and during the construction time, especially in the summer in general, there can be long lineups of cars dropping off all kinds of construction materials. Please slide. Again, we're just going to go quickly through these. So this shows kind of go back again. The scope of materials. So you have wood, you have metals, you have kind of garden residue, you have also clothing, things that are also dangerous materials and so on. But out of all this, there could be a lot of interesting materials to be used. So go ahead, slide. So there's these bins around. This is the way these things are organized, where people come with their cars and they drop off these things into the bins. So this is a nice pile of wood, for example. Go ahead, slide. So here you can see that there's quite a lot of really nice wood mixed in with wood that's maybe a little bit less interesting. Slide. Little beautiful bricks in this one. Go ahead, slide. It's a little slow, I guess. Some metal. So this sometimes there's more interesting. They in fact do recover the metal and they send it off to a third party suppliers that are either selling it or possibly reusing it. I mean, sometimes you have brand new pieces of stainless steel or aluminum and stuff. The point is, keep going down, slide. We have no access as upcyclers to this. So this is in the South Shore. You can see the quantity of metal. So I assume this is being sold somehow because this is, of course, quite valuable. But as citizens or upcyclers, you don't have access to this. Slide. So here are some beautiful tools, pristine, people just throw out. Slide. And here's some books that I thought were quite interesting. Next slide, including a book on the archaeology of economics, which I thought was a little bit ironic given our archaeology colleagues in Toronto. I mean, this could go to all kinds of interesting places. You could have other charities that could connect to this type of material, but they're simply not organized in this way. Slide. It's a little slow, this presenter view. So just to show that we don't have access, go ahead. Since I thought it was a little bit ironic, we talked to the slide. We talked to the organizers who then talked to the city of Montreal. This is e-waste, but maybe some perfectly working speakers or things that could be recovered, but no, we don't have access to this slide. And the city of Montreal ultimately said, no, even for my research project, even Alice was trying to push to see to see if we can get access, and no, they said basically no, they're just not organized for this. Brand new salt and pepper shakers and so on. So that's, I gave up on this track of my research. This was basically a failure of part of my project. So I had to find another tack, which I'll talk about later on in the presentation. You can skip to the end. Oh yes, there's of course these domestic objects which seem to have, that just sit around there. Maybe the employees take them home. They used to have access to this for people who just wanted to come and pick them up, but now the senators have shut that down as well, possibly because of COVID. So what a... Natalie, if there's a way to speed this up, I don't know, maybe exit presenter view. Yeah. Yeah.
Here, I'll share. So everyone's seeing my slides here?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. So basically, I guess we all agree that we're in a sort of a critical and exceedingly complicated situation when it comes to waste and recycling and managing where our products go when they're done. And it seems to go beyond the individual or community. These are ideas that have been in mechanisms that have been in place beyond our reach as consumers, makers, and citizens. But in many ways, I think it's individuals and communities that are working hardest to instigate change. We are a group of, we're in our group anyways, we're exploring this notion of waste. In practice, we are exercising an idea that we're calling deobsolescence. Each in our own way, we're revisiting and reviving and repurposing materials, obsolete discarded technological and material knowledge within our own practice. So here we just got some shots of our work, but Ariel is exploring food waste as a natural dye for garments and inks. Natalie is using corn husks to make new fibers and materials. Patrick, as he was describing, is revisiting discarded objects and giving them new meaning. And myself, I'm sort of finding creative freedom in obsolete programming languages. So we're all kind of looking at how we can sort of look at ideas that were in the past and different ideas to in our work in, I think, interesting ways that you'll learn about in a sec. So this sort of together, we came up with this question: how can design revive discarded or obsolete technological and material knowledge and practice to move us towards a more human-scaled material culture? And this idea of human-scaled material culture is very important, I think, philosophically as we work on our projects. So this is we're going to talk a bit more about obsolescence here. And then this is going to be Tyler, who's going to bring us into this section. Tyler?
Yeah. So
I'll roll it, sir.
You can just hold it for a second.
Sure.
So Alec just mentioned, we've sort of established a new term, deobsolescence. And he sort of explained it, but what to truly understand it, we're going to need to sort of go back to the root word of the term, which is obsolescence. Right? So in this section, we're sort of establishing
each of us wants
how we arrived at the conditions resulting in obsolescence. And as designers and makers, how we're working on solving today's society. And that relates to consumerism, waste, obsolescence, and materiality. So before we hop into this real quick, I'm just going to say, like I said, we're going to look at the history of the planned obsolescence and the rise of consumerist society. And I'm going to say, as media archaeologists, from our side, our job is to find the sort of unknown aspects of media history and the origins of how these things have come to be. So that being said, I will ask Alec to go ahead and play those two clips about planned obsolescence.
Our role in life seems to be just to consume things with credit, to borrow money, to buy things we don't need.
Nous vivons dans une société dominée par une économie de croissance dont la logique est non pas croître pour satisfaire les besoins, mais croître pour croître. Dans une société de croissance, quand il n'y a pas de croissance, c'est catastrophique.
So if the consumer does not purchase, you know, the economy is not going to grow.
Planned obsolescence, the desire on the part of a consumer to own something a little newer, a little sooner than is necessary.
This film will reveal how planned obsolescence has defined our lives ever since the 1920s, when manufacturers started shortening the lives of products to increase consumer demand.
Also hat man sich gedacht, dann beschränken wir einfach die Lebensdauer auf 1000 Stunden.
As planned obsolescence took effect, lifespans fell steadily. In just 2 years, they dropped from 2,500 hours to less than 1,500 hours. By the 1940s, the cartel had reached its goal. 1,000 hours had become the standard lifespan for bulbs.
Young lady, you should be more careful.
General Electric produced an educational film telling consumers that the current lifespan was best.
Just look at that filament. How long a light bulb lasts depends largely on how hot the filament is burned. Samples from every factory are tested to make sure that they're as good as we want them to be.
I can see how this...
Right. So, the two clips you just watched were from a documentary titled The Light Bulb Conspiracy. And that those clips were just sort of excerpts explaining one of the first examples of planned obsolescence being deployed on a mass scale, which was in the 1920s. So specifically, you saw the light bulb and they mentioned something called the cartel. So light bulb manufacturers, specifically those belonging to a conglomerate known as the Phoebus Cartel. And these had companies like General Electric, any sort of major technology and lighting company you would see today were part of this conglomerate, and they're known as the Phoebus Cartel. They recognized the deliberate shortening of a product lifespan as a direct correlation with the replacement of finite essentials like the light bulb, right? And this, they recognized, in turn drove a higher demand and subsequent revenue for themselves. And prior to the 1940s, they had mentioned it briefly, but light bulbs easily had a lifespan of over 2,500 hours, right? And you can see over the evolution, just in that quick couple of decades, they achieved their goal. And by 1940, these companies were boasting about 1,000 hours as being the, you know, the goal technological capability. And it's evident that through this deliberate act of shortening the product life cycle, in order to drive more frequent demand, we're seeing that not only the one of the first instances of planned obsolescence, but it's being performed on a mass scale now. And it's also an evidence of lying to the public, large corporations lying to the public through mass communication media, like these commercials that you just witnessed, to reinforce this ideology. And you can also see that this shift, they sort of mentioned as well, in 1920s, 1940s, it's aligned with that post-war manufacturing boom and that push for mass consumerism.
So I was just going to add a couple of points about the rise of consumerism.
Each of us.
You can just talk while this is going.
Hmm?
Go ahead.
Okay, cool. So basically it was like a couple of major factors in that there had been a gigantic growth in production capacity in a lot of countries during the Second World War for the war effort. And these infrastructures were converted to consumer products afterwards. So promoting consumerism was an active strategy to sort of boost the economy in a lot of Western countries post-World War II. And also a major factor was it was a sort of Cold War era, not quite propaganda, but it was kind of like a nationalist effort especially on the part of the United States and its allies to sort of promote capitalism as freedom, as plenty over communism. So it was very much an ideological thing as well as a material thing. And that just on that point, I'm just going to mention the difference between consumerism and materialism as concepts. We often in public discourse will kind of use them interchangeably, but materialism has many, many, many different definitions depending on the field, and may be used in a way that is similar to consumerism and valuing of material products, but also it has a lot to do with our relationship to the material world and the objects and materials that we interact with on a daily basis. So it's not always bad. So we just wanted to clarify that.
Okay. Thank you.
I think Ariel was going to say a few words.
Yes, so this brings us to a consumer society and the loss of material literacy. So a lot of the time we operate under the illusion that people are separate from nature, but in reality, distancing ourselves from nature has a negative psychological consequence. And that's exactly why we constantly fight it. So for example, have you ever wondered why most people prefer to book accommodations that have a great view from the balcony in the terrace? And so the thing is, we feel so disconnected from the source of where our products come from because we no longer have a purpose. The way technologies and materials have evolved gives us limited space to contribute. And actually a really good key moment to show this is like the pandemic, because there was like it changed the consumer behavior, because for a large section of the population, It provided people the opportunity to reevaluate their current lifestyle choices and make adjustments and reset their lives. So we see a huge emergence of people doing DIYs and everything, when like you could just purchase the products to do these things, but instead people would just want to really do it themselves.
Yes. So as we mentioned about the consumerism disconnect us from nature. I want to make some points from archaeology, media archaeology way. So this is Siegfried Zelinski. So he's the one of the founders of media archaeology. So I think in consumerism, we are not aware of the way we are spending. We shop to be better and acquire status and feel belonged. And also our media advertisements, mass media shape the commodities image and give them with new meaning. So even they give them some human personalities, which means if we have this product, we will have some special status and also some special personality. But what about media technology think of this? So according to Zelinski in his book, So many new products, like Eero said, our DIY products, our many new products can be attributed to some traditional ideas. So if we back to the age of sound, like electricity, there we can find ideas, technology, and and communication theories that influence our life nowadays. So here's the picture, is the example of universal audio system. So it was being designed to monitor citizens like voice. So it can amplify people's voice. So if you look at this picture, it's similar as our like speakers right now, or some home theater. So we can see if we want to create some new thing, new product, or redesign, we can back to the past and to find some ideas that we already have. And I believe the new is the interface between recording the past and opening a new future. And next.
Okay. So part of this idea of obsolescence also relates to technical barriers. I've got a slide here of Star Wars. The reason we're putting this up here is because I don't know if you've ever noticed in Star Wars just how often people are repairing things. So the idea that we can control and be involved in the technology in our world is an interesting one. And in this story, the characters wouldn't survive if they weren't able to repair, fix, and repurpose or reclaim materials for their spaceships, the robots. And it's sort of just a natural thing when you're looking at watching Star Wars. And even when they're doing the new series, they keep the old buttons and switches. So you kind of have this idea of the materiality of the controls. And it's a really interesting aesthetic that that Star Wars has put forward, but it's based on this idea of repair. These ideas are not new, of course. Obviously, this is, if we look at our engines, engines were basically a bunch of parts and materials that you can kind of get in there and work with. Now, not everyone is obviously an engineer or a mechanic, but, the average person might see a broken belt and still be able to point to it and say, that's broken. So this idea that we can get into the tools that we use and the materials and the mechanics and the technology that we use. And the idea too is that this gives us a sort of agency over the product, and we're able to then keep things alive and repurpose. The car is another good example of that, because, people love to, make their vintage cars new again. And these objects are essentially forever new if the owner wants to, and there's a lot of pride in the object of design. So this brings this idea of like what black box technology. So this is something that we're facing more and more. So just a little background, black box technology is any, basically it's a term that describes an unknown process that occurs in a system or an object. There's an input and then there's an output, and the observer sees the change, but they don't know what are the mechanics behind it. Here's an example of an analog circuit, and in it there's a bunch of transistors, diodes, and resistors, but you don't know what's inside there. You just know that you bring in an input, and then outside comes a square wave, a timing chip. This chip would be used in a variety of different products. Same thing in a radio. If a part breaks in an old radio, or even any mechanics where there's through-hole sort of through-hole components like this. If something breaks, you can replace it. You can find the part and you can replace that individual part. That's not the case with a lot of our modern technology. We basically have these really smart devices that are running on really complex microprocessors. They're tiny. Really tiny computers that you can't access. You can't access the material properties within the chips that do a lot more. They're too tiny, they're too invisible. What you do have access, the only way to access that is through code. And the code is designed by engineers, for engineers. And this is kind of interesting because these devices have such a huge impact on our life and on the environment, yet we can't access that. So this sort of right to repair is something that is is being discussed so that companies, basically, when you buy the technology, you have the right to repair it. And this will also include, hopefully eventually include coding in some cases. So I work with students, and actually I talk a lot about this sort of idea of learned helplessness, the idea that, and I compare sort of ideas of app culture and maker culture. And app culture gets you from A to Z. It's always looking for the quickest, often looking for the quickest way there. Whereas maker culture, you're zigzagging, you're finding new things out, you're discovering, and you're learning along the way by making mistakes. And so this idea of learned helplessness is not aided by the fact that we can't get into the things that are controlling the devices in our lives. And as our world is more connected through the Internet of Things and through different, you know, our objects are all smart and they're all connected to our phones. Again, this idea that you need to, the ability to get into the object and repair it or to refurbish it or repurpose it is impossible unless you know how to program. And even then, the code is often, it's proprietary. So you might have a controlled device. So like even John Deere, a good example, you know, farmers are forced to hack into their tractors. And they're voiding the warranties on this huge investment because they need to repair it quick so they can make money. And the fact that they have to go through these giant loopholes by getting, you know, sourcing code or hacking ways of doing it that are in different parts of the world, the fact that the information shared is fantastic, but at the same time, they shouldn't be in that position. You know, safety aside, you know, regulation and other things can really prevent, you know, people accessing the material or the properties of the devices and the objects that they're buying. On top of that, we're kind of bombarded with, you know, if you're buying a new device, a good space to go would be like YouTube, and you're bombarded by technical information. So, you know, phones, cameras are going, they were, you know, when I was in filmmaking, it was 1080p, now it's 4K, 6K, 8K. And you're being introduced to these ideas. You're like, oh, my 4K phone, or my 4K camera is not good enough. I need an 8K camera. And I'm just presenting on YouTube. Well, how important is it if you're in YouTube that you're not actually accessing the resolution that your device is claiming for? So you're marketed these ideas, first gen, second gen, or the components on your computer. Technology is moving us forward. It's making things smaller and the communications are changing, which is great in some ways, but it forces us out of the product. And then we're being encouraged to update constantly. So we're just curious, like, how confident are we in our ability to make and repair things these days, right? And how much effort would that take to actually learn how to do? And this is part of why things become obsolete so quickly. Patrick, I don't know if you want to show your example
quickly. I have this, speaking of Star Wars, a little clock radio, which is inspired from R2-D2. And it wasn't working. The volume thing, as soon as you touched it, it would get super loud or else it wouldn't play at all. And so I looked up a video on how to fix this on YouTube. I watched it quickly. Basically, it's a matter of adding alcohol to the volume adjustment thing inside. And so just to clean it up a bit, and it solved the problem. So I was able to fix it in half an hour or so, including watching the video. It was really easy. So if you want to take a little bit of time to fix things, you can, you know, that's it.
Great. Okay, Natalie.
Yeah, so I just want to go over a little bit of history with humanity and making, and I promise it's not going to be super long, even though it looks like it is. So this, adjusting this slide here, I just want to talk a little bit about some of the earliest stages of our development as a species that we really start to think of as human are our activities in making. So whether that's art, whether that's tools or decorated objects, we really consider making to be an essential human activity. So next slide, please, Alec.
Yep.
Early on, it was kind of a matter of everyone making things as they needed to. As we kind of developed more permanent settlements, we developed more complex ways of making, and it became the necessity to have skilled tradespeople and sort of an artisan type model of making. And that was huge throughout a lot of history. So the examples in the last slide range from around 2000 BC to around like the mid 1700s across many, many cultures around the world. So that would be people train and sort of are in control of their own making. So the next slide. And then during the industrial revolutions, the model very much changed. So while a lot of work was still done on making, in many, many places, the model of it shifted. So increased mechanization meant that people, instead of working for themselves and kind of a smaller subsistence thing, you would have large companies and people would move into cities to work for an employer. And this really, the fact that it was many people producing many products for one company really kind of laid the groundwork for modern capitalism that would come afterwards. And now we have a matter of, it's not just certain people doing work for certain companies. We've also kind of shifted the model of where people, who consumes and who produces. And so you have entire countries that have much more of a service-based economy now, whereas other countries are doing the majority of manufacturing. And there's generally an unequal power dynamic there. And it can kind of be considered like a neo-colonialism in terms of economic colonialism, where resources and labor are being extracted from certain countries by other countries that are wealthier. And yet in this example, we still have, you know, there's still this pushing of these examples are American, but you know, an American company is designed in America, yet it's not actually made there. And I found these are especially interesting examples because especially with America and China, you get, in terms of climate conversations, often the American government will be pushing back against climate efforts because they'll say, well, look at China. But a lot of emissions are coming from manufacturing for American consumers. So there is a lot of separation and the average person in a lot of wealthier countries has started doing more service work, very disconnected from making. We don't seem to value making as much as a skill, as it's less of a job. And so even in terms of individual skills, we've stopped offering home ec classes, we've stopped offering shop classes. There's fewer and fewer opportunities to learn because we don't consider it a good job anymore. So that is.
Yes. Thank you, Natalie. Natalie have presented some good points about the industrial age and what we like nowadays. And here I'm gonna refer to some concept of Fordism and post-Fordism. So as we presented before, Fordism comes from the industrial age. Its mode is standardized, larger scale. But however, after that, the post-Fordism era. So the market tends to be like more diversified and focused on the individualism. So in a post-Fordism system, consumers' choice tend to be more customized. This makes manufacturers and enterprise turns to like small market, okay, some factors, and fragments production process. So all of these lead to squeeze the agricultural space. But however, now more and more people are paying attention to this issue and then considering the future of agriculture. So thank you, next.
Thank you.
Yeah, so I'm just going to quickly mention that, you know, we're seeing the shift from us being producers, maintaining our products to just becoming finite consumers. And the question we're really getting now is, what place is there for individual makers in the consumer society? And it leads us with questions, you know, where do we look for in the past to sort of answer where we're going in the future. Do we need to change our ways? What roles will future designers have, and how will makers come into play there too? And we're really looking to answer those questions in our next section about deobsolescence. However, we're just going to have a quick break, and we're going to be looking at some of my colleagues from Concordia's infomercials here.
Yeah, give me a second here. I'm not sure, we seem to have skipped the slides here. One sec. Okay.
Yeah, we'll be back after these messages.
Yeah, technical difficulty. All right. Here we go.
Prep your volume for this.
Oh, yes. Excuse me. Okay.
Hi, my name is Ariel, and I've stained a lot of shirts in my lifetime. That's why I'm super thankful for natural ingredients such as turmeric. I mean, did you know that you can repurpose old clothing that are no longer wearable to make beautiful natural dyes just like I did? Try it. You need it. Natural dyes, always.
Hey you, do you like stuff?
Yay!
Hate high prices?
Ooh.
Time for you to check out The Curb. The Curb has got everything you need for the lowest prices in town. Furniture, footwear, small appliances, housewares, toys, pet supplies, you name it, we got it. Our items aren't 10% off, they're not 50% off, they're 100% off every day. That's right, pay absolutely nothing for every item the Curb has to offer. Come on down to the Curb, located on every street at the corner of the sidewalk and the road, directly outside your door. It's literally the Curb. Availability of products is sporadic and may vary on location. Some assembly and repair is usually required.
Love it. Thank you. Those are just another little thing here. This is sort of like our little break between sections, but we'll be doing a little demo of logo programming language, which relates to some work of that I'll be doing. So if you're interested, you can scan that QR code, and then you basically, I'll do some demonstrations of logo programming, just a little experiment. This might or might not work, but it's there if you want to try. And I'll just leave that for a second. And then we're going to go in and talk about our work as designers.
Yep. Alice asks that you paste the link in the chat.
I can put it if you want.
Oh, I got it here too.
Okay. But you need to access this link from your phone is the point.
Yeah. So, but you can try just going onto a website. That link should work as well.
Everyone should be familiar with this. If you take your phone's camera and point it to this Q code, it should open the link. And then basically, Alex is going to be doing some things with this a little later on. Is that right?
Yeah, I'm going to play with it just as we're going, but it later on I'll discuss.
So you should see a little turtle on your screen, on your phone, if you've scanned this, or you can also, if you're on Zoom with your phone, you can click on the link in the chat. You don't need any app at all.
No, this is not app form yet, so we're going to be cheating here. This is just a website. Yeah. And if you want the full screen experience, there's a way to do that, but let's not get into that right now. So, all right, without further ado, I'm going to move on. And you can click on the link in the chat for those who are in the chat room. Okay. So deobsolescence, Patrick.
Yeah, so why are we introducing this term? Basically, as we've established, this fixation on endless growth that has been dominating our global economy, it's really depending on the idea of obsolescence, not only in goods and materials, but in terms of the way we work and our processes. So we have computers and we lose the reflex of consulting books. We buy cheap, means that we lose the ability to repair. And we also lose this reflex of repurposing and finding new uses, or perhaps something that we have, we don't even bother finding, oh, this, even if we don't need something, maybe somebody else could use it. We don't even take the time most of the time to do this. So we're introducing the concept of deobsolescence, which is the idea of making useful or relevant materials. So for example, finding new materials and objects, finding new uses for them, repurposing them and so on. Knowledge and practices. So this is about looking for meaning and usefulness in knowledge from the past or practices that may have been forgotten or maybe are considered no longer valid. And then in terms of technology, by the same token, we can find, look for meaning and usefulness in these, even though they've been replaced by higher performance technologies. Like Alex, you were saying, Logo, this Logo programming has been replaced by what language these days?
All languages.
Right.
it's basically, and there's still people using it, but it's not really, it won't make any lists of languages to learn in 2020 yet.
So if you notice your phone and Alex is making it do things now, thanks to Logo language, and which is, maybe you can just, you want to talk, just say a few more words about it?
I'm going to come to this later on. I just, if you're seeing that something, that's great, and we can move on to your section here.
Okay, so I'm going to pass the baton on to, who's up, me?
I think you're up, actually.
Okay,
yeah.
So next slide. So this is my project. So having failed at the upcycling via eco centers for the barriers and wicked problem parameters that we ran into, Alice and I, her trying to help me, I put a call out on Facebook to friends and people who might want to contribute objects to me. And I got all these objects back or suggested in photos, and others were suggested verbally. A few of these I picked off the internet because I didn't have the image for them, such as the guitar case. But I went and picked up a couple. And go to the next slide, please.
Yep.
So this is two objects that came from a friend, Mickey. Do we have the video queued up?
Yep.
Very soon after, you know, I kind of moved on to the next stage of my life, things from that time started breaking down. Like big things like the washing machine, the dryer, you know, he had bought me a scooter for a birthday gift. It was stolen with the insurance. I bought another one. The second one was stolen. A lamp broke, and it kept going on. And it was almost like this metaphor of like, maybe the universe or whatever you believe in was just trying to like, it's over, or I don't know what. It was just, but it was like again and again and again and again. Finally, years later, one of only the few things still from that time is this coffee maker, and the handle breaks.
So part of my approach in this personal call out for objects was to ask people, what is the story behind your object? And Mickey had this great story because this was an object she had got from the breakup of her relationship. And then all these objects, a lot of the objects that she had got out of this sort of divorce or separation had started to break down. But she loved this coffee maker so much that she bought a second one, and the handle again broke. So I said, okay, I have to do something with this. And how can this story inspire? So I started working in the metal shop of Concordia, taking this apart and basically designing, I decided to design a lamp because I thought, oh, maybe some light can come out of the darkness of this relationship. And skip to the next slide. I decided because of the form of this, that it would be an art, there's an Art Deco qualities in the design of this lamp. So I made this Art Deco, spotlight, which I'm calling the Cinecittà, because it's an Italian coffee maker and Cinecittà was the place of cinema in Italy. And it's these kind of lights that were used in the 1920s and 30s to spotlight a movie premiere, a big event with stars arriving. And so this is what I've made. The next project, just quickly, very special object was given to me by someone, Alice, you and Marie Piano, Fiona Annis. She had used it for an art project. And it's a beautiful, still working 5,000 RPM clinical centrifuge, which I managed to take apart with a lot of work, using a blowtorch to heat it up, some rusted screws, a lot of material agency, material literacy learning curve to transform this object, heating up the metal of legs that I wanted to put on it, and using something in the lower corner we see here, it's called the Hofsfeld. It's to bend metal in a way which is really harkens back to another era to result in this planter. So basically I'm calling this invader species, kind of reminiscent of H.G. Wells' War of the Worlds. I may provide a finish on it, but I kind of like the sort of slightly rusty look, and I want to do something else with the motor eventually. But yeah, Ariel, on to you.
Yes. Within the context of food waste and it being such a problem of our time, my project consisted of really finding ways to be more sensitive about food consumption and how can we re-engage in this issue at a home level. And so I came up with the idea that instead of using chemical dyes, there's this hot trend right now, especially with quarantine, about tie-dyeing. Like it's making a really, like the 70s look is really coming back to life and everyone is doing it. And so I thought that it would be super interesting to use those old techniques of folding and tie-dyeing, but doing it with natural ingredients instead. So to re-engage in it at a home level by using my own kitchen to produce these natural dyes. And so this is a bit of the experiments that I've been doing at home. The bottom picture is actually the result of the t-shirt I'm wearing. So that was the one that I boiled with turmeric to get to this natural tie-dyeing t-shirt. And so, yeah, so this is pretty much like the process of doing it. And it was really, really fun.
Oh, cool. That's me. So in my work, I have been exploring the use of corn husks as a source of fiber. And this project started out last year in a different format, but I was working at a restaurant and we had a corn special, and I was finding like, oh my God, no matter, even if you're not wasting any of the corn itself, you still end up with all of this like waste in the form of the husks. And I've also, before getting into design, I also worked in sustainable agriculture, and I was very inspired by permaculture and the idea that every waste product can actually be recycled back into another form, another part of the system, so that you're trying to design as close to a functioning ecosystem as possible. So when I was seeing all these corn husks, I was just like, oh my God, you know, most restaurants don't compost because commercial composting is much more expensive and much less accessible than residential compost services. So I was just like, oh my God, all these things just going away. And then I was like, let's see what we can do with them. So I did a little bit of playing with this last year, and then it was really interesting this year to be able to really lean into it and find out what I could do. So I started looking at older forms, non-industrial forms of fiber harvesting of plant fibers. And so I kind of ended up mushing together all of these different types of practices. So I was looking at ways of processing linen, at ways of processing piña fibers from pineapples, which can make a beautiful, beautiful, super luxurious fiber, but it's incredibly labor intensive. But yeah, so I've been playing with low input manual techniques and playing with it as a non-expert exploration. And it's been really interesting. So even though it's not, you know, it's not super high quality fiber, I'm not trained in fibers, but it's amazing to be able to get something useful out of it just by leaning into it and asking questions. So yeah, I've got, as you can see in the picture, a working string. But yeah, go ahead, Alec.
Oh, okay, sorry, I didn't mean to jump there. I'm going to skip through here. Basically, I got interested in the Logo programming language. I have an acquaintance who was involved in a lot of its development, and he's done things like send satellites and control satellites in space with Logo. And I was working on installations, and I was basically like, why am I not using this? It's so easy to read and write, and it's interactive and playful. It's a great way to create. I like to sort of learn from my mistakes. And it's a language that was designed in the 60s as a learning language. And these ideas of learning through mistakes and constructionism is embedded within the language itself. It's a very easy accessible language. So I was curious, and basically I started seeing what I could do with the language. I used it to embed into custom electronics that I made make clocks. And then skip forward here. I'm actually right now just exploring it, this version of it called Art Logo that Brian Silverman invented as a way to sort of beam visuals onto phones so that we could do some kind of installation with it. I'm really interested in the playful element. I could use there's obviously languages available, but there's an element that's sort of like very concrete with Logo that I appreciate. And so the phone as being a bricked environment, I thought it'd be neat to sort of use that as a way to explore it. Here are some examples of me doing some timing devices using Logo. And I don't know those who are on the screen, I'm just sort of just doing live examples in the background here, changing the visuals, making little animations. And yeah, ideally this would be an app on your phone. Ideally you could have a language like this on every phone where when you're done with the phone, you can give it to your kids, or you could use it yourself and use the sensors and the screens and all the parts inside the phone. So I'm kind of speculating what a phone would be like if you had access to the inner workings of that black box technology. Okay, so I think that's it for our demonstrations here. Natalie?
Yeah, so I was just gonna hop in. We're a bit over time, so I think it might be best if we can do our next portion sort of as a casual, like a back and forth conversation, if anybody has points in our group to bring up. I think a lot of it we've touched on already. But yeah, and if anybody has questions too, that would be great.
Do we have questions from the group? You can post in the chat or raise your hand or jump in the conversation spontaneously.
Yeah, notably about, I think some of the interesting things that we've been talking about is in terms of making as a form, as a response to obsolescence and as a form of deobsolescence. One of the things that we like about it is that it brings so much emotional satisfaction and engagement with things. And in this time of pandemic where everyone is, you know, alienated and separated and fragmented and so much on social media, we've seen how making has been a way for people to feel connected, to engage in a slower form of life, to start making bread and so on. So like, I'd be interested if people have thoughts on this or on this process of making as a form of maybe community engagement or emotional resilience, for example.
Hi, Patrick. I'm just going to jump in quickly. Thank you so much, everyone, for a super interesting presentation. And I just want to show you guys that, like, you can alter things and fix things within, even when you watch a presentation, which I just did now. So basically, these cups here have been bothering me for months, and on and off I would wear it, but it had an elastic. And I basically used my little seam ripper. And as you were talking, I just managed to take the whole thing off, and now it's awesome, and I can wear it, and I don't have to throw it away.
Yes!
Awesome.
Love it.
And so I think maybe I was also inspired to finally get it done while I was listening to all of you. So that's great. So yeah, I think it's also a mental barrier, I can say, because a lot of this alpha adolescence topic was actually really addressed in my research work, just in the recent months dealing with textile waste, really. And many of the questions, well, often I would stop and think like, okay, if I don't want to dispose this, what will I do? But it takes a certain mental energy, you know, to get started sometimes. And once you start, you're like done in no time, in 20 minutes, you know, sometimes. So I think it's also this kind of, you know, and to have fun with it. Sometimes we see it as more of another chore we have to do. To fix things, but like you also mentioned, you can learn new things and reconnect with the material, the object. It becomes more a part of you. You have a story for it. I mean, this was done, this top was created in Montreal by a Montreal designer that I actually met, and it was a gift from somebody I knew. And so it's also like a connection, right? She was a young designer. I saw her hustling on her bike, like carrying her materials from the fabric store home, you know? So again, this kind of connection, I think it's coming back. We're rebuilding.
And
shop
just
on Etsy now too. And,
you can do that too with technical things. It doesn't have to be like, so it's easy to see that with fabric and like you can use, you got the physical tools, but even, you know, software and electronics, those are also accessible. It's just, we maybe need to reapproach how we teach and learn it and
Yeah, yesterday we came with the concept perhaps of design for reassembly, right? So it's not just a matter of design. So like how we can reassemble after. So it's interesting to give another life cycle to things. It was a good presentation. Natalie, did you want to answer?
Yeah, I was just going to say, when we were in the talks yesterday, I was really thinking that, and I was like, oh, I want to jump in, but also, oh, but we want to keep some of our stuff for tomorrow. But no, it really relates back to the concept of emotional durability too. And that is, I've got his name somewhere. But yeah, and just the idea that engaging with the objects in your life, and whether it's caring for them or having to fix them or having a story behind them and experiences with them, like it gives you a reason to connect to them. And it's not just, oh, it's not new anymore, I don't really care. But basically forming, even though we're all always saying like, oh, you know, don't get attached to objects, like they're just objects, they're not real. But if we can form attachments to the objects that we have in our lives, then we don't necessarily need to be going through so many of them. We can be much, much more responsible with them.
This is an invitation that Gilbert Simondon gives us, or he invites us to do, to consider technical objects as social beings. So like to consider them as entering in a social relationship rather than a consumption or, so it I think it ties well with Natalia's question. She says that your group talked about the potential positives of materialism. Is there a way to talk about the potential positives about consumerism, given its tenacious hold and presence in our society? So it's kind of interesting to see process or the continuum from both sides. So do you see any kind of positives on the consumerism side?
I find that one harder.
Go ahead, Natalie.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I find that one harder to engage with often just like because of personal bias. But I guess there's some things like when it goes right, if innovation fueled by consumer trends goes right, sometimes that can be really awesome. Like, this is just a very personal, very small scale thing, but you know, as like non-dairy milks have become more popular in the mainstream, there have been many more brands making better versions of them, and not just better versions, but like less destructive versions. So, you know, we went from soy milk to almond milk to oat milk, and oat milk is much lower impact than almond milk. And as a lactose intolerant person, I can now find that easily anywhere. And it's more commonplace, but in general, I often have trouble engaging with the positives of consumers. And so I'll pass that to someone else.
I can hop in on that. Like Natalie actually just alluded to it a little bit, but competition is a major driving factor, right? Technological development from consumerism. So while it can be said, you know, there's obviously issues with being connected to a specific object so much so, but technological development and innovation, like I said, is driven through competition. So we can see this in any sort of mobile devices, right? Recently, there's a push for, you've seen the new like folding screens, for example, right? 10 years ago, right? That would be unheard of. But now we're having these OLED screens that can be folded, and you're seeing all these manufacturers are pushing to innovate and get theirs better than the other ones. So you can see that as a potential benefit. The other one I would mention, which is maybe a bit more close to the soul rather than, you know, hard cash and things like that, is you know, a drive to create a community out of specific objects. And I didn't really get to mention it, but I will address it right here. One idea is the concept of residual media. John Davis mentions it. Basically, old media, right? That sort of, it's a counter narrative against consumerism. It keeps pushing back. It won't let the media die. Like a record store, for example, right? That's a, you know, it can be an indirect consequence, but a positive one of consumerism. There's communities that are being created out of a specific attachment to an object or a technological idea, right? And it creates a community out of that. It creates a love for a specific object.
I think sort of adding on to that, I feel like what we've said is kind of like it can harness excitement and emotion, right, about certain things. So maybe if we consider that and try to use it more with more intent, there's a potential there.
There's a, Yilong mentioned, I think it was the Project Ara, right? The modular Google phone that never happened. That was actually the idea for that. One of the first ideas for that was Phone Blocks, which was Dave Hackins. So basically, he's a designer, and he's proposing an alternative way to do a phone, and that got industry excited, and they started prototyping this idea. Unfortunately, it didn't happen, but you now see DIY examples online of people making modular phones. So the designer and the maker have a lot of potential here to influence, which is a really unique time, I think, because of the sharing of knowledge. So I think that's all the time we have, right, Alice?
Well, yeah, thank you for your presentation. Thanks for this engaging conversation. I have tons of questions for you, especially concerning black boxing, literacy, education, and de-obsolescence. However, I think maybe we can add like a little post-mortem discussion after, because the second panel needs to prepare and present after the break.
Yeah, and thank you very much. It was quite insightful, very interesting. I have more questions at the end and at the beginning, so it's a good sign, you know. So, and I have to say, I love your little info commercial with America. Okay, like I really, I couldn't stop laughing in my office. Thanks for that.
Thank you.
Natalie,
I shared the link in the chat to watch.
Yeah, awesome.
Thank you very much, guys, and we'll see you in about 10 minutes.
Okay, now 1 second. Everyone can take a short break. However, we'll keep the Zoom open for the second group to prepare their slides and make sure that everything is okay. Okay. So basically, we will start again at 11:10 sharp. So 10 past 11. That's good?
Correct.
And okay, so I'll go make a coffee if you don't mind. I think you're okay.
Yes, just, thank you.
Just breathe, have fun. You're all amazing. It will be fantastic. Okay. And if you need to go over 12 p.m., that's perfectly fine. No worries. Okay.
Yeah.
So we have until 12:30. And I know it's getting late for Janice. Janice, my apologies. I know it's difficult at that time of the day.
Okay, guys, I'm also going to make coffee, and I can't wait to hear you. Like, you guys are super well organized. We know that for the last meeting, so I'm sure it's going to go super well.
Yeah, so, right, I think we're live now. Are we live? No.
But I see the live, too, on the top left.